I solved the problem of an array of fibers under compression with this non-local variable for different value of kappa. And what I see that for kappa, for the local model, this is the curve you had until the snapback. For kappa equals zero, you actually recover the same behavior. But for kappa larger than some critical value, you see that failure takes place before. You have actually a sudden failure of the whole bundle. Abruptly, you have catastrophic failure, and the force goes to zero. And this is the critical displacement that is here, or here, or here, as function of kappa. Below some critical value, it's always failure always takes place here. And it is a snapback point for the local model. And as kappa increases, the failure takes place earlier and earlier. And this is different level of disorder, but you essentially see that. And yeah. And so kappa, you can, and I think the peak is somewhere here. So the failure can take place after the peak or before the peak. This is also an interesting feature that, contrary to local model that systematically predict at worst localization at peak, you can, changing interaction, you control when this instability takes place. Another interesting feature that is more subtle is that if you look at kappa equal 2 times kappa c, the stress strain behavior deviates a little bit from the local model right before catastrophic failure. There is a little deviation here. We'll see what it corresponds to. And then there is a catastrophic failure of the bundle here.
This snapback, first of all, is it seen experimentally?
No, impossible. Huh? It's a purely theoretical curve because you cannot drive, you cannot come back, and you don't have time. No. Snapbacks, it corresponds to catastrophic failure. Yeah. Because delta can only increase. Yeah. Or you have a very a good feedback, but all right. So now let's look a little bit more at the damage field in the bundle. At any time, so I've solved numerically. We solved numerically this problem. So at any time, we know the damage field in the bundle, and I compute the standard deviation of the damage field in the specimen. As function of the average damage level or as function of displacement, that is the same thing. So at the beginning of the experiment, I have zero damage when the standard deviation of damage reaches a plateau. And then before catastrophic failure that takes place here, I have an increase of the standard deviation of the damage field, meaning that the damage field becomes very heterogeneous. At least here it was 1% fluctuation due to the disorder that I have introduced, but here something special happened. There is a really damage field will become very heterogeneous. And so you have three phases. The first phase, well, zero phases is elastic, then damage increase until the value dh, that is essentially homogeneous growth of damage, every element behaves the same, and then there is a phase where you have a heterogeneous growth of damage and standard deviation explodes, and then at d equal dc you have catastrophic failure, meaning that at a little increase of displacement suddenly all the damage grows to one and all the bones are broken. Okay, and to understand a bit more what's going on in this phase, we calculate the power spectrum of the damage field. The power spectrum, as you may know, will help you to reveal if there is any periodicity in the damage field. If there is a periodicity, it will show you a peak. And indeed, it shows a peak, and here it's power spectrum computed at different distance to catastrophic failure. The blue curve is right before catastrophic failure. These curves there are far away from failure at the beginning. So you see that there is an emergence of a peak that shows that there is a mod that is building up in your damage field, the emergence of a structure with a characteristic wavelength. And as I call it here, I call it in that toy model, it's a kind of localization. You will see essentially a periodic structure of the damage field building up over some months. So, okay, this everything seems very mysterious. So, let me move to the theoretical part now. How do we understand that? And these are the basic theoretical block I will use later for 3D elastodamageable solids. So, this is a way to understand in a simpler settings how it works. So, how do you? The basic idea is essentially to do a stability analysis of the damage field and to see if you could see the emergence of these modes and if you could predict catastrophic failure. So linear stability analysis can be done the following way. You consider that your damage field is not homogeneous. It's a constant d naught plus some perturbation that can be anything, delta d of x. And you want to compute the distribution of damage driving force in your specimen. Damage driving force is defined as y bar minus yc. If it's positive, then you know that you have failure. And so the damage driving force can be written as a sum of a constant plus a perturbation. And this perturbation always takes the same shape. Actually, you recover the redistribution function introduced earlier. The perturbation in the damage driving force writes as this redistribution kernel psi convolute with the perturbation in the damage field. If you replace this delta d by a Dirac, you get only that, and that's what we call the redistribution. Okay? It's exactly how we calculate. We consider a Dirac as a local perturbation of the damage field, and we add a redistribution of damage driving force given by this function psi. Everything makes sense. So the question is, okay, psi, I already give you the expression, we know how to calculate it. And so what you consider then, you consider harmonic perturbation. Delta D as cosine Qx, where Q is a mod of your perturbation that you're going to test. And if you plug that into that, you actually, it's not exactly that. You consider perturbation mod, delta D of X, as delta D naught 1 plus cosine QX. Why do I take a 1? I only want a positive increase of delta D to respect irreversible growth of damage. So I have a damage field. That is around here, and I perturbate it with a small harmonic mod of wavelengths 2 pi over Q. Okay, and then I, from this formula, I can compute the new driving force of damage. The driving force of damage is not anymore constant, but it's also vary in cos, in sinusoidal manner, sorry. Opa. And I have, previously it was this, and now I have an update that tries at cosine, the same cosine than here, with the same wavelengths, but a sign that depends on that. So let's assume this being positive, then I have same phases than here. It means that, let's take this point A. The damage is larger here. The damage driving force is also larger here. This is an instable mode. Because where the damage is already larger, the damage driving force is larger. But if this term here is negative, I will have an opposite sign here. All right, so it will mean that when the damage is larger, the driving force is smaller. So ultimately, when I will reload, the perturbation will smoothen out, and the damage driving force will be bigger here than here. So it will smoothen out the perturbation. So this is an important quantity, and its sign is very important. Then you have another. So this allows me to tell if a perturbation will grow or disappear when I will go on reloading. This is another argument. This is another thing that tells you if what does it tell exactly? Under constant. Yeah, it tells you if the perturbation, even without increasing, it tells you the position of this point with respect to the reference point. So I have perturbed slightly my my damage field. That's the new damage driving force is lower or above the previous one. If it's above, it means that without increasing the displacement, a little variation of damage field make my driving force increases. It's an instable process, okay? I'm under fixed displacement condition here. So it's a little subtle, but essentially I have two arguments based on these values that are two criteria. One telling me if the mod will grow, but on a stable manner, and one will tell me about if the mod will grow but unstably, meaning that under fixed displacement condition. Okay, so now you plot psi, this function that we can calculate analytically as function of q for different loadings, and what you see is that there is a mod that is emerging here for QC, for Q equal QC, and that touch zero for some critical damage level or critical displacement that correspond to this condition. At this point, this mod is unstable and I have localization. To have failure, I need that plus that equal to zero, so I need this point plus this point be larger than zero. So I need to grow up and I bit here and here. At this displacement, I will have failure. Okay, so what you can do from this, you can predict, you can do that for each value of kappa. This set of curves can be done for each value of kappa. And you can predict the displacement at localization as function of kappa. And the displacement at failure as a function of kappa here represented as a function in comparison with the numerical solution, the numerical observations. Okay? So it makes a good job at capturing the localization threshold and the failure threshold. So what is the main message is that if you know the redistribution kernel, you can predict localization, you can predict failure, you need to look at the Fourier transform of this redistribution. I should have explicitly plugged that. If you plug the cosine here, you convolute cosine with that, it turns out that it gives you the Fourier transform of the kernel applied in Q, where Q was the mod you were investigated. That's the main result. Okay, maybe I skip that because I'm going to lack of time. But essentially, you get two different scenarios. The first one, if kappa is larger than kappa c, what's going on? When you load your sample or when the damage increases, you get first of all, this is delta d. This is the fluctuation of the damage field. This is the average value of the damage field. Essentially, you have homogeneous growth of damage. You arrive to a first bifurcation point where you have a mod that is called a localized mod, and essentially the damage field will look something like sinusoidal. With, in my toy model, the wavelength is set by the length scale L of my interaction function introduced in alpha, so I somehow fix the wavelength. And then the amplitude of this mod will grow until catastrophic failure, until that without even increasing displacement, damage will grow to 1. And I have another regime where here I have directly catastrophic failure without emergence of localization mode. It corresponds actually to the first instable mode is Q equals zero, or wavelength infinite, or it's an homogeneous mode that is unstable first. Okay, so this is in the time model. The key message that we need to convey through that time model is that the non-local function that we have chosen at the beginning control fully these two bifurcations. For example, the parameter kappa allows you to move from here to here. That's interesting from a numerics perspective because in computational damage mechanics, you choose alpha that is convenient for you and you plug it to make prediction. But you see that if you choose an alpha or another, you might have completely different results. So this interaction function should be properly chosen. That's the main message. And if you choose it properly after, you have this toolbox that allows you to predict localization and failure. Okay, so now let's come back to the original question, how we can calculate this this kernel for real material. So for now I'm going to consider essentially 2D elastodamageable solid, but 2D means that under some compression the damage field is invariant in the transverse direction. But we extended it to 3D. So the results are essentially the qualitatively the same. So what is the definition of the redistribution kernel? You want to know what is the driving force, the field of driving force Y for an heterogeneous field of damage. So the damage is written as D naught plus some perturbation, and your driving force for damage is a constant plus some perturbation that writes at the kernel that I'm looking for, convolute with the perturbation. That's the definition of this kernel. That is called the redistribution kernel. And you see, if you consider a Dirac function for delta D, you get directly psi as the update of damage driving force. So now we want to compute that for an elastodamageable solid, a 3D solid, following elasticity, but having elastic constant that depends on the damage parameter. So here I take a general model. I don't set mu of D and K of D. They can be whatever micromechanic model you want, and I choose a different form that this morning here the elastic energy is written as a function of the strain through these two contributions. And as we show this morning, the driving force for damage, the rate of elastic energy released, is the variation of the elastic energy with respect to D with a minus sign under constant epsilon. So it's straightforward here. It's mu prime, and you have the mu prime and K prime here. And you can write that using Hooke's law in terms of stress field, where you introduce mu bar and k bar, that is the inverse of mu and k. Okay, now comes the difficult part. Now you're going to consider, this is for homogeneous, actually now I'm considering an infinite medium under homogeneous loading condition. So for homogeneous medium, epsilon and sigma is given by the external epsilon and sigma is homogeneous and equal to the same value everywhere. Now I'm going to perturbate the damage field as D naught, a constant, plus some random perturbation. What are the implications? D controls the elastic moduli. If I vary D, I vary locally elastic moduli. So the elasticity problem is becoming different. The elasticity constants are varying in space. So the stress field has no reason to remain the same. So the stress field, right as a constant, that is a zero order solution for no perturbation, plus some perturbation delta sigma. What about the driving force for damage? Same thing, because locally, the elastic energy stored in some material point will depend on the elastic constant and the local mechanical field. So same thing, I will have a perturbation. So the main work is to calculate this perturbation. So I show you the two formulas, the time. I'm not going to show you the detail, but the time I plug the battery. I'm running out of battery. Up. Ah! Should go in. Okay. It goes like that, even better. All right. Not sure I make it. Oh, great. Okay. Okay, we take a chair. All right, perfect. Yeah, it goes. Sounds good. It's not charging, but it's not charging.
You didn't switch off something else. Now it should be.
I switch off something, but should not. Yeah, it's charging now, but I switch off the other guy, probably. No, it's charging, but I think that this one, I plug it now. This one, I change it, but this is why I got.
Okay, no problem. There is no power.
No. Well, that's okay. We'll manage like that. It's okay. You want to plug it up?
Maybe tomorrow you get a.
Yeah, it's charging. Excellent. So. Can you try now? Because I plug it like as it was before.
No, this is fine.
Are you sure? It's not that?
Yeah, don't do anything.
Okay.
It's breaking.
Oh, it's he received some. Okay. Okay, so maybe I'm going to then discuss essentially the result of this calculation. So essentially, you have a damage field. Let's consider the following problem. Uniaxial compression. What you consider is that the damage field is heterogeneous, is D naught plus some small fluctuation of some small variation of damage field. The implication is that the elastic constant are also slightly perturbated. So what you need to resolve is an elasticity problem with heterogeneous or slightly varying elastic constant. This is related to the HLB problem. You can connect this problem to HLB. But the next step, so then you can indeed calculate the variation of mechanical field, in particular the variation in stress field. You can do it even in 3D. But then the following step is also to compute the variation in elastic energy release rate. That is the quantity that interests us, and that is related to the variation that relates to the variation of elastic energy stored in each element that depend on x. All right, so this is the final expression that I didn't even, oh, you have to, I think that's fine, thank you. So this is the final expression for the variation of stress field in Fourier. That you see, it can be written as a function of the variation in delta D in Fourier, so the delta D of X, or delta D of Q, sorry, involving essentially involving what? The prefactor is the elastic constant, the variation of the elastic constant, the derivative, the stress field applied before the variation. Here, for uniaxial compression, is only is a sigma naught for this case is 1, is that. Okay, so you plug it. And this Hossein tensor that is a classic in this kind of problem that writes as function of the Fourier mode. And so this perturbation in the mechanical field, you need to plug it inside there. It's a bit of calculation, but when you plug it inside there, what you get? You get the variation in elastic energy release rate as function of the first second derivative of the elastic constant and sigma naught that is known here. And finally, you find something of the form in Fourier, if you go in Fourier since Sézier, you find something on the form. The delta y in Fourier is a function time delta d that is here, and that will come also from delta sigma. Delta sigma is proportional to delta d. So you end up with a very long expression, but you can factorize delta d and you get your kernel. Okay? I'm going to apply, this is a general expression in whatever loading condition, so obviously it's complex. What is interesting, in the real space, it takes a form that we like very much, we know actually. In 2D, it's a function of theta in the real space. So this is r and theta instead of x of z. X of and y, sorry. R and theta. We have a form by an angular function divided by R2. This redistribution function is simple to picture. Is a redistribution of damage driving force of loading you get if you get locally an increase of damage. So this is the plot of the redistribution function under shear and under pure compression. Under shear is a classic, you're going to recognize. If you have an increase of damage in zero, you have a redistribution of driving force positively along four directions. So if you have a damage increase under shear, if you have a damage here taking place, a damage event, you're going to redistribute and reload the four region at 45 degrees to reload this region that may break because of this event with a decrease in 1 over R2 in 2D, 1 over R3 in 3D. And you're going to unload this other region. All right. Under uniaxial compression, what do you see? In the uniaxial compression, you see that you reload the lateral region. Because what's going on is when you have a damage event here, you soften the material. So if you soften the material, the load has to be carried by the neighboring guy. So you reload the guy there, and you unload, you screen the guy above and below. So it tells you essentially how interaction takes place in the material when a damage event takes place. And in collective process, describing the interaction is a key point to be able to make prediction. Okay, so now stability analysis. So this, I'm not going to redemonstrate that. We discussed it in the toy model. The stability analysis, you just need to look at the Fourier transform of your redistribution kernel. Well, you already feel that, I'm going to discuss that in a minute, but strictly we proceed the same way. You take the Fourier transform of the redistribution kernel we calculated, and the instable mods are given by this being positive. And so what do you find? Because of the particular shape of the redistribution kernel, you find that this Fourier transform doesn't depend on the amplitude Q, but only depend on its orientation in Fourier space, that will correspond to some orientation in the real space also. And so it means that when you become unstable, you have wavelengths, you have all wavelengths being unstable at the same time. So you don't have a characteristic wavelength. Hopefully, because we have solved an elasticity problem, there is no characteristic wavelength. But all the mods have all the same direction in Fourier space, meaning that in the direct space, they also have the same direction. So essentially, when I'm compressing this guy, no surprise, the unstable mods are going to be parallel to this. But I will have unstable mod, like my unstable damage mod will be with some sinusoidal variation like this, with some wavelengths. But the same one with smaller wavelengths will be also unstable. And actually, all the mods that oscillate in that direction will be unstable. So I have a bunch of harmonic mods all oriented in this direction. And the real localization mod is the sum between all these guys. And then to go further, you need to do a nonlinear analysis that we don't know how to do. But for sure, the instable mod is aligned with this direction. So we expect a band that will be aligned in that direction. Well, for this case, it's straightforward because you see the lobe are here. But for other cases, it's not that straightforward. Okay, so indeed, you can look at an experiment under pure compression. I will proceed to a more systematic test of the theory. But the experiment we ran was you tell me about the time. Huh? Okay, so the unstable mod, in the experiment we run, we use cellular solid, uniaxial compression test, and confinement. And the localization band we observe were horizontal. Well, that's not, I will discuss in detail this experiment tomorrow. And for this particular, material, we have assumed a constant Poisson ratio and a Young modulus that decrease with D. And then the kernel takes a much nicer shape, that is this shape, the redistribution kernel. It's a sinus to the power 4. And it is in the Fourier space. It is maximum for Qx equal pi over 2 equal 0. Sorry, for in the Fourier space. It is maximum when this is a minus, so when omega is zero. So when Qx, when omega is zero, my mod is oriented along Qx. That's it. It's of the type cosine Qx time x. And so my localization angle is my localization angle is pi over 2 plus omega c, is going to be 90 degrees. So x is vertical, my localization angle is going to be horizontal. And okay, in this experiment it is consistent, but there is no real challenge. So what I propose you is what we wanted to do is to proceed to a systematic test of the stability analysis. Are we able to predict systematically the localization angle with this approach? So to do a systematic study, the easiest and simplest way was to to compare with numerical observation. And so in the remaining 5 minutes, I'm going to describe you the simulation we have been using. So it's simulation tools developed in the 90s, where you can predict the evolution of the damage field in a specimen with slight heterogeneous distribution of material property at the onset, and you incrementally compute the damage field following the procedure explained here. So first you increase, so the geometry we use is compression with some confinement ratio that is sigma 2 over sigma 1 that is smaller than 1. Okay, we have we impose the stress on the borders. So first you impose the displacement right here. You calculate the driving force for damage everywhere. You check if there is any material element that satisfies the damage criterion. If it's the case, you increase the damage in the point satisfying the damage criterion. Then, if D increases, you need to update the elastic constant that depends on D, and to update the stress field through finite element calculation, you need to solve an elasticity problem with heterogeneous elastic constant. And so you can incrementally compute. If when you update the damage field, that's exactly what we saw, you're going to have redistribution of damage driving force. So you may induce other part of your specimen to break. And you have this avalanche statistics that I will discuss tomorrow. But so you come back here, you check if there is no one that may break, and if some other point satisfy damage criterion, you go on in the loop under fixed delta until the instability, the micro instability stops, and then when all the material elements are stable with the damage criterion not satisfied, you increase the loading again. So step by step, you can have the evolution of damage, and you can also have the stress strain response. So it goes through a peak and then reach a plateau, and the picture that is shown here is far away from the peak, and localization takes place about that the peak, but if you wait a little bit more, you see the localization bend very clearly. Sorry?
It's not flat.
Yeah, then after this is a process of accumulation of damage in the band that is beyond the theory here, and that is a process of maybe accumulation of damage within the band. But we are not interested by that, we are interested by the inclination of the band, and so there is a method that is well known, this projection histogram method. Maybe I skip it, but essentially you are able from the numerics to extract the inclination of the localization band systematically. And okay, then comes the theoretical prediction. And the objective was to compare local versus non-local criterion. Local criterion, what it is? Okay, it turns out that for this simulation, we didn't use the criterion y equal yc that I showed you before. It's a stress-based criterion, but doesn't change the concept. Instead of comparing y, elastic energy release rate, with yc, resistance, you compare, you use the Coulomb criterion that consists in comparing the local Coulomb stress that is defined as for any plane the tangential minus mu times the normal stress, and you compare this Coulomb stress with the cohesive stress of your material at this point that will correspond to your yc if you want. And in the there is a parameter that is key for your criterion, is called the friction angle, that is the arctangent of the friction coefficient. that is that we're going to vary in the following. So a classical result is that if you take the Mohr-Coulomb criterion, you expect localization, or you expect that the plane that will break first has an angle that is pi over 4 minus phi over 2, where phi is your input in your model, that is the internal friction angle. This is the standard Mohr-Coulomb theory, but this is a local criterion. If you have one element, or if you have non-interacting elements, this is the prediction you will get, and this is rather straightforward, it only depends on phi. It turns out that the same calculation of redistribution kernel can be done, because when you damage somewhere in your material, you redistribute the Coulomb stress for the same reason that you redistribute elastic energy release rate, except that here you can stop at this point. You don't need to calculate delta y, you need to calculate delta tau and delta sigma n. Okay, you can do that, and you turn out that you have another redistribution kernel that is a bit nasty here, but if you look at the Fourier mode, at the mode of unstable mode of damage growth, you find that its orientation is not the one given by Mohr-Coulomb, it's another orientation, and it's a bit more complex. It depends on two parameters, the friction, the internal friction angle, but also on this parameter delta, that I unfortunately don't explicit. Delta is here. Delta is a function of Poisson ratio and confinement. So it's a bit more complex. So I have two predictions, and I compare with the numeric. So these points are the numerical prediction, our numerical observation. For the localization angle as function of the friction internal friction angle. And this is the Mohr-Coulomb prediction, local criterion, and this is the inclination of the most unstable mode, taking into account the interaction. And here, the theory, the non-local theory makes a good job in the limit of small disorder. If you have a strong disorder, you see some deviation, but anyway, the local criterion doesn't make a good job. There is another interesting effect is now you change the Poisson ratio of your material. If you change the Poisson ratio, you see that you change the inclination of the band for nu equal 0 to nu equal 0.5. You see that the inclination of the band will decrease. And this is captured by the instability analysis, stability analysis. Mohr-Coulomb is here. Mohr-Coulomb doesn't predict you any dependence with Poisson ratio. This is interesting because it tells you that the fact it depends on Poisson ratio tells you that this unstable mode emerges from elastic interaction. You change Poisson ratio, you change elastic redistribution takes place, and so you change the nature of the mode. You change the inclination, you change also the critical loading for localization, and so the instability analysis capture this effect. Another effect is the effect of the confinement. If you increase the confinement, the angle of the localization band increases, and the stability analysis still capture reasonably well that, and once again, Mohr-Coulomb doesn't predict any effect of confinement. Here, it's another interesting feature that the idea of the Mohr-Coulomb criterion, or the idea of the local criterion, is to look at one material element and to look at its stability. But we say right here that the localization is the result of collaboration between elements and interaction between elements that can be captured through the interaction function psi. Okay, so it's time to conclude. So the take-home message is localization can be seen as the emergence of an unstable collective mode of damage that you can predict through stability analysis. And the next step I will discuss tomorrow is, can we reveal this cooperativity and this collective behavior by the precursory damage activity that takes place prior localization? Alors, so in elastic plastic models, there is systematically. This is actually the kernel in elastoplastic model is not derived from elasticity. It's derived from is proposed ad hoc. Is the first, I think, proposition come from observation in experiment where they see redistribution in the quadrupolar geometry. But strictly speaking, there is no proof that STZ leads to that. It's also a main difference, but it's actually I implicitly propose that actually what happened in amorphous plasticity model is local softening and redistribution through that kind of calculation. A key difference is that if we change the boundary condition, if we use compression, the redistribution is very different. And now I don't know if in models of amorphous plasticity, if you move to shear loading to another loading, you will change that. And it's a key feature saying that we say that this is not a material property. This is a property of the structure. This is a mix between the material property, how elasticity constant change with damage, and specimen geometry boundary condition. And I think it's not the message in plasticity of amorphous media, but since I think always the shearing is considered, it's not clear how things will happen in elsewhere.
Questions we break for today. So thank you to all the speakers.